Good evening, everyone. Please come on in and find a seat if you are sitting. Please come on in and find an appropriate place to symbolically die if you are dying. We had planned tonight to have a panel discussion with some of the leading scholars in our field talking about putting bodies on the line. We scheduled this many, many months ago. And I'll confess to you that we scheduled this at the time thinking this was going to be a celebration. We thought it was going to be a celebration of the first woman president. We thought it was going to be a celebration of America making a confirmation of civil rights and justice and equality. And we asked the speakers who are here tonight to speak because we know they embody these values. They are some of our bravest and smartest and most honorable members. They're the members who show us how we could all be better. And then on Tuesday night, I can't speak for all of you, but I know I was stunned. My heart was broken. I think, like many of you, I spent the next day talking to my children and trying to explain to them, how did this happen? And my poor little ninth grade daughter said to me, are there really 54 million people who believe in racism? How do you talk a ninth grader down off that ledge? So, what we have here is another group of our brave and brightest and most committed scholars who, in a great tradition of the American Civil Rights Movement, have come to us to symbolically die. This is called a die-in. I bet a lot of you have done this before. Last time I got arrested was at a die-in outside a nuclear weapons plant. We've forgotten that nuclear weapons exist, don't we? But we used to protest at them, and so I was at one outside dying, and we all got arrested because we were blocking the entrance into the plant. And so your colleagues around you, your fellow teachers, your fellow scholars, you're on committees with these people. They are your friends and your neighbors, and they are here to symbolically die. And I've asked Amber, who has organized this, to say a few words to put this in context for us. So Amber, will you say a few words to us, please?
Tuesday night felt like death to a lot of us, but a lot of us felt like death long before Tuesday night. And we started to organize this action before Trump was elected because we want NCA to stand up, to rise up, to make a statement in the public that says we care about social justice and we are here for our scholars of color, our trans scholars, our scholars that are gender nonconforming, our scholars that are Muslim, our scholars that are Palestinian, all of the scholars. And we want to make sure that we come into this space acknowledging that we are complicitly engaging in acts of violence when we separate ourselves from the communities that we are supposed to be serving. But at the same time, we can use our bodies and our voice and our scholarship to make a difference. And so today we symbolically die in because we want to make sure that this idea of putting our bodies on the line has more to do with the lines we write, right? It has more to do with the lines we teach in the classroom. It's about action. So please feel free to join us on the line if you want to. We welcome all of you to participate. And when this is over, we are going to go downstairs to the lobby and die in again. Thank you so much.
So thank you, Amber. Thank you to everyone who's come. For those of you in the back, there are seats in front. If you want to come up, there's plenty of seats. Let me remind everybody, tomorrow morning at 9:30, the Social Justice Exchange is an opportunity to come together and to meet almost 40 local Philadelphia groups committed to civic engagement, social justice, doing the right thing, employing communication for the common good. So you have so many opportunities over the next 3 days to plug in. Make your energy a part of the solution. And that's really what we're here to do tonight, and that's why we have these amazing, amazing speakers to share what they do with you and to introduce the panel, one of my heroes, a real leader in the field. Please welcome to the microphone from the University of Colorado Boulder, Dr. Lisa Flores.
Good evening. Is that on? Yes. It is my great pleasure to welcome you both to the opening session generously sponsored by Rutledge and Taylor & Francis, and to the 2016 National Communication Association Annual Convention. As we know, as we witness, as we feel, the contemporary cultural moment is a moment that we must respond to. It's a moment, an election that shocked and saddened us. And it's a time that we need to come to terms with what this sweeping Trump election surely signals about the state of the nation, in which we witness daily national and global struggles and challenges. But at this meeting, as Stephen just pointed out, we have an opportunity, and it's an opportunity to stop, to pause, to reflect, to assess, to re-energize, to refocus our efforts, thinking as we listen to and engage with our colleagues' work about the intersections of communication scholarship and civic engagement. There is perhaps no greater imperative than the call of the conference and of this session. And as so many folks have made clear, at least in my Facebook feeds over the last couple of days, this is a time for organizing, for working with the fullness of our presence. Because despite the hate, there is daily evidence right here of communities coming together, refusing silence, and naming hope. Stephen Hartnett's conference theme, Communication Civics Callings, has produced a range of innovative opportunities to participate in conversations on communication and civic engagement, from the social justice exchange he just identified, to the Carol Arnold lecture on Friday evening, which is going to feature Kurt Wilson and his work, Dreams of Union, Days of Conflict, Communicating Social Justice and Civil Rights Memory in an Age of Barack Obama, to the many, many panels across the divisions and caucuses that take us to different points of entry into communication and civic engagement, to this, our opening session, putting bodies on the line and words into action, celebrating the joys of challenges in and opportunities for civic engagement. Tonight, we have the opportunity to listen to and learn from three distinguished scholars and civic actors, Dean and Professor Bryant Keith Alexander, Professor Mohan Dutta, and Associate Professor Billie Murray, all of whom have devoted their academic careers to the communicative pursuit of civic engagement and social justice. And I can't think of a better way to open this conference than with this conversation with these three amazing folks. I'm going to tell you more about them in just a minute. But before I do so, I'd like to reflect for just a moment on the imperative that this conference theme names: communication and civic engagement. As I prepared for this conference and I thought about the theme, especially in these last few weeks as I thought about this, I went back to a conversation that I had with our incoming graduate student cohort early in the semester. And we had read a series of readings reflecting disciplinary conversations on whether we can consider ourselves a discipline, on what it is that unites us despite our many differences. And as we worked through that, we came back again and again to our shared commitment to research and teaching that addresses social problems. It's here where we are all implicated in communication civic calling. For it's our shared sort of fundamental assumption that theoretically and in our praxis, our task as communication scholars is to address social problems. We have a range of paths and entry points, but I suspect that for all of us here, it's why we do what we do, because we know that our work matters, that communication's constitutive force means that we can and we must intervene. But I'm reminded as well, and I'm always reminded this when I come to our annual convention, that our job is one with considerable privilege. It is a part of our job to spend 4 days together in intellectual conversation and in friendship. And that privilege, like all privilege, comes with responsibility. And it's here that I know, at that privilege and that responsibility, that I still have so much to learn. And particularly in spaces like this opening session, where our panelists come here to share the ways in which they put their bodies on the line, and in which we have the great opportunity to see this happening in practice. So let me tell you a little bit about our three speakers. We begin with Bryant Keith Alexander. Professor Alexander is Dean of the College of Communication and Fine Arts and Professor of Communication Studies at Loyola Marymount University. Across his career, Professor Alexander has achieved considerable distinction with 2 monographs and an edited anthology, a range of edited special issues, almost 50 refereed articles, more chapters, presentations, keynotes, and performances than can easily be counted. He's the recipient of the 2016 H.L. Bud Goodall Jr. and Nick Gorey Trujillo It's a Way of Life Award in Narrative Ethnography, the Master Teacher Award from WSCA, the Best Book Award from NCA's Ethnography Division, and the Special Recognition Award for Outstanding Achievement and Contributions with the LGBTQ+ Campus Community from Cal State LA. And those are just a few of his awards. Professor Alexander's academic work exemplifies the spirit of this opening session. Regularly putting his body on the line in his scholarship, Professor Alexander has devoted at least the last 18 years since receiving his PhD to challenging scholars to think theory and pedagogy at the intersections of race and sexuality. A performance studies scholar with a research program that names blackness and queerness, Professor Alexander asks, if not expects, the discipline to rethink the imperative behind our work. His most recent scholarship, done during his tenure as dean, centers blackness, queerness, violence, and identity. Without hesitation or a moment of pause, Professor Alexander names the racial and racist violence that currently spirals around this country, making clear to readers that we cannot continue to look away, that we live in a nation in which no black body is safe. Consider his words here from a recent essay. My academic and professional accomplishments or status do not shelter this black male body on the public streets of discontent. Even as a black male professor, dean, I write under surveillance and suspicion. I write under a history that always suspects my worth, value, and intentions. Professor Mohan Dutta is Provost Chair, Professor, and Head of the Department of Communication and New Media at the National University of Singapore, where he is also Founding Director of the Center for a Cultured Center Approach to Research and Evaluation, CARE. This is a center which prioritizes community-based projects for social change. With over 170 articles and chapters, Professor Dutta has been named as the most published scholar in health communication. Also named the Lewis Donahue Outstanding Scholar in Health Communication in 2006, and a university faculty scholar by Purdue University, the recipient of teaching awards for both his graduate and undergraduate teaching, Professor Dutta is quite clearly a scholar and teacher of considerable distinction. Like Professor Alexander, Professor Dutta comes to this session as the embodiment of its theme. With a research program devoted to the approach he himself developed, culture-centered research, an approach that prioritizes academic-activist collaboration and listens to typically silenced communities, Professor Dutta devotes his career to scholarly interventions. He asks questions such as how structure, agency, and culture interact, and how marginalized and disenfranchised communities might resist and reframe oppressive structures. His work is grounded in an ethic of community participation and knowledge, and he maintains that community work is central to social change. Listen to this challenge that he poses to us as faculty. The work we carry out as scholars is grounded upon the fabric of community life, based on the taxes paid by everyday citizens, and much more importantly, on the goodwill of communities that give universities land, trust, legitimacy. But for a large number of faculty, university life goes on, walled from the everydayness of the communities we live in, disconnected from the spirits of community life. Our third panelist is Professor Billie Murray, newly tenured and promoted associate professor in the Department of Communication at Villanova University, where she has been since completing her degree in 2010. With a research and teaching profile that has generated considerable attention and praise, Professor Murray writes and teaches at the intersections of rhetoric, social justice, and activism. With articles in such notable places as Communication Theory and First Amendment Studies, and awards for her teaching, research, and service, including the Ethos Award for Character and Excellence in Communication, awarded by the Villanova chapter of Lambda Pi Eta, and the Martha Nell Hardy Award for Outstanding Teaching, Professor Murray brings to this panel, as to all of her work, an ethic of scholarly integrity, care, and compassion, and a model of what it means to be a rhetorical activist. Professor Murray integrates scholarly and community interests across her research, attending to questions such as how can our scholarship rethink knowledge production while also producing social change. Professor Murray draws on both her rhetorical sensibilities, particularly as wed to questions of public sphere and public spaces, and her activist involvement in social issues, such as Occupy, to consider how communities might be better fostered and restored. As she herself explains, events such as the shooting at Emmanuel AME Church in Charleston can traumatize communities. Responding to what now seems like the inevitable hate speech that follows such events can provide opportunities to restore community. Standing up to hate in those contexts can provide unique opportunities to explore corporeal modes of expression. If the spectacular variety of hate speech is truly on the rise, we should be open to a broader range of responses to hate speech. These three amazing folks are giving us their time tonight. Please help join me in welcoming them.
Friends, I am I'm completely moved, not only for this opportunity to be here and to engage you in this manner, but in completely, slightly overwhelmed by our colleagues who literally were placing their body on the line. And I hope that they know that all of us who are seated up here and all of you who are seated in the audience were with them in mind and spirit. I teetered many different times on the nature of my presentation this evening, and I found myself consistently thinking about two major concepts. One, the notion of dense particularity offered by Satya Mahanty, and the other is Gus Yep's theorizing on thick or thicker intersectionalities, and particularly the manner in which both of those constructs sort of speaks to the multiplicity of aspects of our identities and the ways in which we sometimes separate those within discussions of intersectionality, but the ways in which he calls us to attend, to seriously attend, to the manner in which all aspects of our identity sort of coincide and come to a confluence, creating a powerful sense of our particular sense of being in the world. And what I decided to do is that I decided to draw on a recent message that I offered to a group of aspiring young minority students who were interested in graduate programs in California and the United States. At Loyola Marymount University, we hosted the Southern California Forum for Diversity, designed to recruit traditionally underrepresented populations into graduate programs. And standing in front of them and also thinking in anticipation of standing in front of you, I offer them a part of the following message, which for me serves as a critical act of civic engagement. I told them this, and this is an echo. Every day I place my body on the line because I know that in addition to being a good teacher, a good scholar, and a good administrator, I am always and already a black and gay man in a place that did not pre-anticipate my presence. And I'm not exclusively talking about the Catholic Jesuit University that I teach at, but higher education as a whole. Every day I operate in the thick intersectionality of my identity as a black, gay, man, teacher, scholar, administrator, amongst other things, unabashedly, without shame and without pause, grabbing and grappling without shame, grappling at the possibilities of my being and becoming, and hoping that I that how I explore these issues in my scholarship and advocate these issues in my leadership, in my presence, and in my being are truly acts of civic activism that I hope make a difference. Makes a difference not only for the students of color or queer identified students who are desperately needing representation, but also those others who are grappling with their own implicit biases in higher education and who are sincerely seeking to restrain, to contain, to change their misorientation to others as to transform institutions of higher education and thus transform society. Every day I operate in the fullness of my identities, always knowing that my presence is both personal and political, as well as promotional and pedagogical, as an object lesson of possibility, as a template of sociality, helping to transform the formidable construction of the white ivory tower, creating a more habitable space for those like you and those like me, who will come seeking to explore the possibility of their own dense particularity, and thus also helping the institutions of my engagement and your engagement to better fulfill their compelling missions of true inclusion and access to excellence. Throughout the speech to those prospective students, I repeated the mantra, and I will repeat it to you: we need you here, here, in higher education, here in the nexus of educational opportunity, a professional uplift, and where your presence and intellect can help to disrupt the politics of racial representation in colleges and universities and around the world as spaces of both presence and absence, of stress and striving for minority and ethnic men and women. We need you here, I told them, and I tell you, here in the graduate programs that serve as the cradle of possibility for critical intellectual and social dialogue that produces higher level thinkers, practitioners, researchers, and creators to have influence on the local, national, and international levels in our professional lives and in the communities that we call home. Here, in graduate programs, in scholarly conferences, where information formation can lead to transformation of self and others and society. Here, in graduate programs that prepare students for advanced positions of leadership and impact across professions and fields. We need you here, I said to them, and I say to you. Here, in a place where students not unlike them, not unlike many in the room tonight, from Yale University to the University of Missouri and campuses between and beyond, have been protesting around the country, protesting about the lack of representation, of not seeing faculty of color in their classrooms and in positions of authority and leadership, protesting against the subtle racism, implicit bias, cultural incompetence, and microaggressions that have been a part of their educational experiences in predominantly white universities around the country, protesting because aspects of their cultural cosmologies, their ways of seeing and knowing themselves in the world, are not represented in the curriculum at the universities that they attend. We need you in these places and these spaces where your presence interrupts the day-to-day routine in which implicit biases go unchallenged. Implicit biases about what a graduate student looks like, about what a professor looks like, about what an administrator looks like and acts like. We need you here. We need your thick intersectionalities. We need your brilliance and your beauty in graduate and doctoral programs around the nation. I told them that we need them, but that I need them. I need them as graduate students. I need them as colleagues. I need them as collaborators. I need them as instigators and conspirators in changing the face of higher education as we collectively place our dense particularities on the line for a purpose, not just to teeter, but to trump the lines that threaten to regulate our minority, our mobility, and our possibility. And now, considering the outcome of our presidential election, more so than ever, we need both the large-scale acts of protests in which people literally place their bodies on the line that are happening here at this conference, that are happening around the country, but also everyday acts of civic engagement, a critical messaging and advocacy for inclusion, for diversity and democracy in everyday practices, in the places where we live, in the places that we play, in the places that we work. Thank you.
That surely is a hard act to follow. I also see so much hope being here, being amidst you, and being in between you. Hope that bodies on the line do matter, that they do make a difference, and that communication can transform. I want to take a moment to thank Professor Stephen Hartnett for putting together this amazing conference, Communications Civic Callings. Hopefully, it is also a transformative moment for us as a discipline to recognize the powerful role that we play as communicators in making a socially just, better world. I'm both humbled and delighted to share stories with you from my field work. I feel very little sitting on this panel, really, but I will still make an attempt to share some of these stories, drawing attention to the ways in which perhaps communication can be transformative, offering bridges between lives of scholars slash activists that can be precarious, but that also can be incredibly powerful in imagining a different world. As I share the stories that I will work on, I want to thank the labor of the people that do the work that I'm going to share with you. The community organizers, the activists, the research scholars spread all over the globe who put their bodies on the line. So this talk is not going to be so much about me and how I put my body on the line, but rather a celebration of the others that I have the opportunity to work with and the ways in which they negotiate risks in their life every day. The solidarity of scholars and activists offers sometimes risks to the body. But these risks that we bear are also incredible moments for changing the narrative. So when I offer hope as a narrative entry point, I also see communication as a seed for building about hope. I will begin by sharing with you voices of two community organizers that I have collaborated with over the last decade or so. One is Rosie Thomas. She's from Lake County, you know, from Gary, Indiana, south of Chicago. I've worked with Rosie on a project called Communities and Universities Addressing Health Disparities and the Indiana Health Disparities Coalition. Listen to what Rosie has to say. The powerful want to tell things the way they see them, in their own way, in the ways that feed their interests. So what is your role? She's asking me as an academic. Work with us. Collaborate on things that we can do on the ground that represent our interests. It has been so many times that our interests are not really heard. This is a theme, one of listening, that I will come back to again and again. And I will hopefully highlight how important it is for a work of social justice to actually pay attention to listening to the ground, not taking the ground for granted, and not taking people's agency for granted, not clubbing people together as the uneducated mass, as if they do not have ways of making sense of the world. In my humble experience, when I understand social justice, I think of it first and foremost as the work that needs to be done in understanding the people and the communities we work with. So Rosie says, we work together in making the avenues where our voices can be heard such that they matter. And that's an important challenge that she places in front of us as academics, to find platforms, to find infrastructures such that the voices of margins can matter, such that they can be registered. Now we are going to move all the way from Indiana to India. This is Telangana, India, south of India. This is a collective of women farmers that I work with. And the women farmers run a local community radio where they take the radio as a way for telling the stories to the world in the ways in which they see these stories. So Nadamma, who is a lead community organizer and an advisory board member of the Deccan Development Society, which is a local community radio, says when we hold these cameras, so this is a radio collective of women farmers who document their everyday lives with cameras, and in doing so, turn the gaze on the stories. So she says, when we hold these cameras, we tell our stories. When we run the radio station in the community, we tell the stories grounded in our lives. So it is not the money that the big people pay to sell their version, which is always about making profit by making fools of us. So on the radio, there are stories of what farmers are really going through here in Warangal. Warangal is one of the epidemic sites of farmer suicides in India, and in Pastapur. These are two neighboring villages. In both these narratives, I think there is a common thread that runs through, which is the sense of erasure that communities at the margins experience, the sense that they do not have a voice. And sometimes I feel when I reflect upon my own practice, that my practices work toward reproducing these erasures rather than creating spaces for listening to these voices. So what I would argue for is we look at the ways in which communication acts as a site of erasure. I will take you through two particular case studies that we will look at closely, one based out of Singapore and one based out of India. This is some of the work that we do in Singapore with the working poor. And in Singapore, the narrative of the working poor suggests that when you see the image of a glittering city, the skyscrapers and the glittering buildings, where are the stories that we have to share? Where are the stories of our struggles? And the question, if I am a Singaporean, why am I left behind? This idea then, that I will work through, is the ways in which communication works to erase, the ways in which it works to hide, particularly when communicative resources are located within structures that are owned by state and corporate interests, meaning that when the fundamental infrastructures of communication have been taken over by the elite, what then are the spaces that those at the margins can find for their voices to be registered? In this sense, when communication works as erasure, what you have here in this diagram is the interplay of state, civil society, and market, working through the mechanisms of democracy and capitalism to reproduce a particular form of democracy, a form of democracy that listens to particular interests that have the capacity to be registered, and yet simultaneously erases those many other voices that do not find entry into these platforms. This is what I call the Davos consensus, the consensus that articulates problems from the standpoint of elites and therefore seeks to bring about solutions directed at the margins based on the understandings that the elites bring to the table. So drawing from Spivak's Can the Subaltern Speak?, the classic essay where Spivak argues the subaltern is subaltern because she is fundamentally disconnected from paths of mobility. I argue that the new subaltern, which she refers to in her later work, is precisely subaltern because her body is the site of profit. Her production of knowledge, her indigenous cosmologies are the new sites where profits are regenerated through the Davos consensus. where things like patenting of indigenous knowledge forms the basis of entire industries of biopharma that co-opt this knowledge in order to circulate it within the networks of transnational capital. So within this context then, what does it mean to think about the question of how we go about building infrastructures for listening to the voices of the margins? I will walk through, as I said, an example of India, and then I will look quickly at Singapore to demonstrate the points I'm making. The first instance, I will talk about subaltern bodies and extractive industries. To set up the case, I will demonstrate to you a map of India. If you look at the distribution of mineral resources and mineral wealth in India, these are the dark blue and green dots. You can see that there is a big concentration of these mineral resources in the eastern part of India. These are also the spaces that are occupied by India's indigenous communities. So think Standing Rock. What does it then mean in terms of the role of the state within the context of indigeneity? With these extractive industries, the state frames a narrative of development to create programs that fundamentally displace these indigenous communities from their sources of livelihood. A lot of my work then within this context is reframing questions of livelihood and health from within cosmologies of indigenous communities. In this backdrop then, what you also have is state-sponsored military and police violence that is carried out in the name of development. Meaning, development is used as a trope to mark those indigenous bodies as terror or threats of terror. So here, I think we also ought to be attentive to narratives of security, geosecurity, and how these are deployed, particularly turn on the subjects within one's own spaces. So bodies then within these contexts become sites for disruption because they tell stories that offer different narratives. They disrupt the narrative of extraction as development. They disrupt the narrative of extraction as job creation. And instead, they offer us other entry points for imagining a relationship with the world. Cultural stories in this sense are resources that communities draw upon to offer a different narrative. So the work of academic activist collaboration becomes one of listening to these cultural stories to register these alternative rationalities of how we go about organizing and understanding the world. This is an image that you see here are of two indigenous icons in the indigenous culture of India, Sidhu and Kanu, who led the indigenous fight against the British imperialism and British colonists in the early part of the independence movement of India. The indigenous communities draw upon the narratives of Sidhu and Kanu to narrate a different story of development, a story of development that is grounded in notions of indigenous sovereignty, indigenous independence. Within this backdrop then of storytelling that disrupts structures, bodies that tell these stories are at risk. Here, for instance, I have for you the book by my colleague and author Nandini Sundar, who is a professor working in these tribal areas of Bastar, recording the violence carried out by the state on its indigenous people. And just 3 days ago, Professor Sundar has been framed in murder charges for murdering an indigenous person. That tells you the ways in which the power of the state works to craft particular narratives, to silence alternative imaginations. The question then really becomes for us, how do we create these spaces for other imaginations, knowing that these spaces are contingent and precarious? I will briefly play a clip from a narrative from the indigenous context of their resistance to show you how this story of development is disrupted.
Oh.
So the story and the power of storytelling, when turned into the hands of the margins, fundamentally transform what we think about as material, the relationship of the material to the symbolic, and in this context, for instance, what do we think about as the idea of progress and economic growth. The work of communication, therefore, the transformative work of communication, therefore, I believe, is the power of the stories that we tell. And the challenge for us is, how do we listen in contexts where it is hard for us to listen, to make space for these stories to be told? Thank you.
I'm used to working on a Mac, and this is not a Mac. There we go. Okay. I want to start by thanking you, Dr. Flores, so much for your very generous and kind introduction and for serving as chair for this session. And I obviously want to thank the members of the die-in who gave us a very poignant example to think about in terms of this week's election. I'd like to thank the NCA First Vice President. I saw him a minute ago. I lost him somewhere. For inviting me to be part of this panel. An invitation that I wholly resisted, especially when I found out I would be sharing a stage with Bryant and Mohan. And having seen both of them present at other conferences, I'm pretty horrified to be following. But all is not lost, because I see a lot of my friends and colleagues from Villanova are here, and I thank you for your support. It means the world to me. Obviously, I had a presentation done ages ago for this panel, which I mostly scrapped yesterday. So my apologies if this is not as polished as it should be, if I'm a little too tied to my notes. But I'm not going to apologize for its now pretty partisan nature. I guess you could say that after Tuesday, I'm tired of walking that line. I will try my best to remain hopeful for you, my colleagues, and also for myself. I've spent the better part of the past year facing down hate groups in South Carolina and Georgia. So I feel like I'm ready to face down this new hate in presidential clothing. A quick warning that I will be showing images from neo-Nazi and Klan rallies, so they do contain some symbols that are racist and disturbing. 6 months ago, when I wrote the abstract and title for this presentation, I was thinking a lot about lines. Walking the line, crossing the line, drawing a line in the sand, putting bodies on the line. After Tuesday, I think it's fair to say that a line has been drawn. We, as communication scholars, or as activists, if you are one, we will have to decide which side of the line we are on. The more I have thought about all of these lines, the more I have struggled to navigate activism and scholarship simultaneously. Early in my academic career, as a graduate student, I first became interested in the rhetoric of social protest, but I often found that I couldn't answer the questions I was most interested in without being in the field. Once I was in that space, though, I found the idea of being a neutral observer ethically problematic. And so I crossed what was still, at that time, a line between scholarly research and activism. Under the amazing mentorship of Robbie Cox, who was an activist scholar before it was cool, and who never loses hope despite these trying times. I began to explore what it meant to be an activist scholar, to learn where I should draw the line, if anywhere, between these two pursuits. My current research, as Dr. Flores mentioned, focuses more specifically on how people use protest to respond to hate speech. In the past 48 hours, I've been thinking about those responses to hate, or lack of them, in a very different light. Whenever I talk to people about my work on hate speech, I inevitably spend time trying to convince them that neo-Nazis and the KKK are serious threats in this country. Now I think, what would happen if more of us had taken these groups seriously? We can no longer just dismiss them as crazy extremists. They have been mobilized and emboldened by a presidential candidate, and their rhetoric has won him the highest office in the country. This past year, I've had a bounty of fieldwork opportunities as hate groups across the country have become more publicly active and received unprecedented mainstream media attention via the platform of the US presidential election cycle. In 2015, 892 hate groups were operating in the United States. That's a 14% increase from the year before. I feel pretty sure this number will be higher when the 2016 numbers are released. Here in Pennsylvania, there are 40 of these freshly galvanized hate groups, including the Klan, neo-Nazis, skinheads, anti-LGBTQ groups, a Holocaust denial group, anti-Muslim groups, and more. The city of brotherly love is not immune to hate, and now it seems neither is our electoral process. But before I go too far down the rabbit hole of despair I have been trying to drag myself out of this week, I want to focus a bit on what I see in the field as a scholar and an activist that gives me hope in these increasingly trying times. Most importantly, my fieldwork has proven to me time and again that although hate clearly abounds, so does love. When I rewrote this presentation yesterday, I thought long and hard about whether or not I still believe that. And when I think about the people I have stood with this year, I can honestly say that I do. People come together to respond to hate in amazing ways. They put their bodies on the line, they form lines of resistance, and they too draw lines in the sand. They say, no, not in my town. And I know that people will come together now and say, no, not in my country. We will despair, we will grieve, but we will also get back to work because we have to. With that in mind, I would like to share a few stories from my activist research that I hope will be helpful as you decide where to draw your own lines between activism and scholarship, or when you're faced with having to cross those lines. This past April, I attended a counter-protest of an openly pro-white march, their title, at Stone Mountain in Georgia. Neo-Nazi and Klan groups gathered with numerous Confederate flags and large banners reading things like diversity equals white genocide. Although constitutionally, Stone Mountain Park had to grant a permit for their march, the officials placed them in the most out-of-the-way parking lot down a one-way street and barricaded the entrance to all park-goers and counter-protesters. They were trying to hide the racists, but we wanted them in plain sight. We wanted to confront them. So after about an hour of trying to figure out where the pro-white rally was being held, Stone Mountain Park is enormous, we found the all too common lines of police officers in riot gear, armed with flash bombs, clubs, and rubber bullets, lined up about four officers thick near the barricaded street access. But the counter-protesters were not to be denied a confrontation with the white supremacists. We hiked through the woods, crossing the thin blue line, in order to make sure the racists knew that they were outnumbered and they would have to face us. We were maneuvered around cops, catching a glimpse of the numerous buses and vans that were ready to take people to jail, all to toe the line, to stand face to face with the hate mongers. And even though we still had a large parking lot and a line of police armed to the teeth in front of us, we chanted loudly to make sure they all could hear.
I believe that we will win. I believe that we will win. I believe that we will win. I believe
record, I still believe that we will win. Crossing that line that day was an arrestable offense, and I hesitated to cross it. I was untenured at the time, and I thought, was I putting my career on the line for my activism? And then I thought, as a researcher, am I risking removal from this space and thus missing out on the data collection that I really needed? Activist scholars have to make these kind of hard choices all the time when they are standing on the front lines. Choices that involve conflicts among our ethics, our scholarship, the jobs we love, and our own self-preservation. Those choices are hard, but sometimes you just have to cross the line. When I feel like I've crossed the line too far afield from my research, though, I remember the words, and some of you have heard me say this before, from Larry Fry, who once said to me, "If you want to be an activist, then go be an activist. But remember that you came back to the academy for a reason." I have to remind myself that sometimes I need to walk the line between my scholarship and my activism a bit more carefully, because I am both a scholar and an activist. But sometimes the line seems too thick. This has been most apparent to me since I began working on hate speech issues, because it puts two of my most cherished ethical positions, protecting free speech and combating hate, on opposite sides of the line. This line between free speech and hate speech is a difficult one for me. As a communication professional whose national association's very mission is dedicated to fostering and promoting free and ethical communication, how can I ethically seek to shut down the speech of others? Most free speech scholars tend to accept the idea that freedom for speech we hate is essential to preserving First Amendment rights for all of us. But not all communication scholars find themselves on that side of the line. They disagree that free speech to that degree is productive in democratic societies. Many critical race theorists, for example, have argued that First Amendment protection for hate speech violates the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment. And therein is the line I struggle to walk. I know freedom of speech should be protected, but I also believe there should be protections for people who suffer the brunt of hate speech harms. And now more than ever, they need that protection. But how to walk the line? Through activism, to be sure, but also through research. In Whitney versus California, Justice Louis Brandeis put the onus on communities to meet hate speech with more speech. And it was through my research into that idea that I learned how to walk the line between free speech and hate speech. I used my scholarship as a means to research what more speech looks like in our contemporary moment. Walking this line has allowed me to navigate the theoretical and ethical obstacles on both sides of it. And this worked really well for a while. But then in June of last year, the line began to blur as I dealt with the emotional aftermath of the hate crime perpetrated against the parishioners of the Emmanuel AME Church in my hometown of Charleston, South Carolina. I grew up just outside of Charleston. I lived and went to college less than 3 blocks from Emmanuel AME, and I've walked past it probably 100 times. Being in Charleston after the shooting turned the line between hate speech and free speech from a research question into an emotional struggle. Dylan Roof exposed himself to so much hate speech and convinced himself to commit this horrible crime as a result of that hate speech. Now we have our entire country exposed to similar ideas through the platform of the US presidential election, and half of them convince themselves to vote accordingly. But does that mean that we should censor the hate speech because of what it might lead to? After what happened in Charleston and after this election, I began to think maybe so. Maybe the price of protecting some speech is just too high in contexts where guns are so easily accessible and hate abounds. But then I thought, how long would it be before the speech of some other group, groups we so desperately need to hear right now, groups like Black Lives Matter, would be erroneously put in the same category and subjected to the same censorship because someone thinks it might lead to violence against police officers? I don't really have an answer for this question. I'm still standing on the line, but the struggle is what's important. And sometimes the struggle leads me to draw a line in the sand. In July of last year, I went back to South Carolina, this time to Columbia, where the Confederate flag was finally removed from the State House grounds. Something I never thought I'd see happen, to be honest. A group of neo-Nazis and KKK members staged a protest in response. There I saw hundreds of counter-protesters, though. Counter-protesters from all walks of life, holding the line against these white supremacists. But these activists drew a line in the sand, one that some of my communication friends and scholars might disagree with. We were not there to dialogue. Certain conditions have to be in place for dialogue. People have to come to the table willing to accept the inherent worth of the person opposite them. They have to be willing to listen, and at the very least, to think about ideas that go against their own. So when you're dealing with rabid racists, with the possibility of violence, with so much unbridled hate, is dialogue really possible? Is it even ethical in those situations? As activists, we drew a line in the sand. There would be no dialogue with hate. We were not there to talk to these people. We were there to demonstrate that hate will not go unanswered in our community. So much is possible when communities come together to stand against hate, when people use the communicative power of their bodies to form a line, to say, no, we will not ignore this, we will not tolerate this. This is a different way of thinking about more speech, to be sure, but as I crossed back over the line to scholarship that afternoon, writing my field notes, I realized it is one that we, as communication scholars, are uniquely able to explore, even if it means putting our bodies on the line. Earlier that day, before the rally started in full swing, I saw a man wearing a large sign with a red target painted on it that said, "Unarmed black man, don't miss." I was absolutely terrified for him, much like I am terrified for people of color across the country right now. This man was walking around alone. There were already a few Klan members and skinheads walking around too, not to mention a ridiculous number of heavily armed police officers. And I couldn't bear to see him walking alone like that, a target. So I stood with him for a while and I told him how scared I was for his safety. He put his hand on my shoulder, looked me straight in the eyes, and said with so much sincerity, "I have to do what I have to do. We all have to do what we have to do." And in that moment, I got it. I've learned a lot about how to do research on protest, but that day, I learned a lot more about how to do activism, about what it truly means to put your body on the line for social justice. And what I learned is that I can draw lines between my scholarship and activism. I can draw lines in my writing and in my teaching, but when it comes to my own personal moments of choice, to my ethics, I have to do what I have to do. I have to put my body on the line with those activists, maybe even cross a line or two to say no to hate and to bigotry and misogyny and violence. When things get harder, and I think they most certainly will, I hope we will all do what we have to do. I hope we will all walk the line.
Have agreed to save some time for question and answer, and I know they would love to engage in conversation with you. We have a little bit of time. We have a good bit of time.
Yes.
That was just a blanket question.
Would you stand and kind of just for volume?
I know it's not comfortable, but it's really not. Could you repeat that?
Do I have a lawyer? Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, lawyers. I think,
Billie, would you restate some of that?
Sure. So the question being, like, I think essentially, if I can paraphrase a little bit, is how do I protect myself in terms of legal issues, but also in terms of actual physical protection, and are my sort of family are my family members ready to sort of respond if something does happen to me? My response to that question is, I have a lot of skin privilege that makes me not in nearly as much danger as you are on that line. And so no, I don't have lawyers. I depend on the National Lawyers Guild when I'm in those spaces to protect me in terms of my civil liberties. And I've certainly talked to my family about some of the dangers inherent in this, but the dangers to me are nowhere near what they are to people of color, to trans people, to genderqueer people. And so for me, that's really the more important question, is how do we, when we are in those spaces and we are allies and we look like me, right, when we are white, how do we work to protect the people who are much more vulnerable in those situations? And I've seen people respond in really terrible ways, that where a lot of people, and almost exclusively white people, will provoke police, will try to get arrested as a badge of honor because they know they're just going to get arrested. They're not going to get shot, right? And the people of color in those spaces are put in more danger when white people make those choices.
May I comment on the question as well? I need to tell you that I absolutely love and I absolutely hate the question at the same time, right? And both because it forces us to think about a literal answer to the question, right? But even, and this is the thing that's probably going to keep me up tonight, is the sort of figurative question at play, right? And the way in which we have to think about the ultimate consequences of our behaviors, of our engagements, of our activism, no matter how that plays out, whether that is an immediate threat to the physical body, or what we heard within the context of this presentation as well, in terms of the untenured body, right? And the ways in which we always have to be in this place of negotiating the balance, right? And gaining some sort of commitment to the nature of what it is that we feel so passionately about, right? And so in some ways, I don't want to hear the literal answer to the question, as much as I want us to sort of ponder collectively, right, what this question is sort of invoking in each and every one of us, to think about the implications and the complications, you know, of the choices that we make and the commitments that we make and how we do what we do and why we do it and being able to live with what happens after, right? And so I love the question and I hate the question and I thank you for it, right?
Can I just say one more thing about that? Thinking about your presentation is, I don't tell my mom when I go to these, because she doesn't need that anxiety in her life. But when I used to tell her, when she used to know about it, she would say, you can't do that. You can't put yourself at risk like that. You're a mom, you can't do that. And I said, who am I to not risk? Who am I to say that my life doesn't have to involve risk when so many people in this country's lives involve risk just by being who they are? So now I don't tell her these things. So.
Yeah. Sure, back in the back.
I thought he was drawing our attention to something. If he asked a question, I didn't hear him. I'm sorry. But yeah, that would be helpful.
Oh, don't. And that's the question, how far can you go? Push it.
Something that I've been grappling with in the last 24, 48 hours is some accusations that I've been hearing about an ivory tower that has not listened to narratives that resulted in the election outcome that we have. And I think I've been struggling with whether as academics we have been isolated from those stories, or whether the outcome of the election reflects a resistance to the kind of stories that we're trying to articulate. And so that's been a confusion for me, and I really appreciate all three of you shedding light on the need to continue telling the stories of people that haven't been voiced over these years, and I'm wondering where in that space do we have a responsibility to listen, if at all, to the people who feel like they had to speak out to their vote for this particular presidential candidate.
I'll just suggest sort of a tentative big picture narrative. I think that's a really important question, particularly when it comes to marking off bodies as the hick or the uneducated person. I think there is room for listening, particularly in terms of questions of, say, trans-Pacific partnership, economic marginalization, opportunities of participation, and considering in that sense, and I would love to hear your thoughts, Billie, in this context, whether dialogue offers at least a potential entry point for understanding, because it would seem like if you want to organize, right, and I come from that very pragmatic standpoint, you would need to build allies, you would need those spaces that you can transform such that you can have a broader base to organize with and organize from.
And I'm probably gonna contradict myself now. I think you're absolutely right. I think for me, in terms of this idea of dialogue and listening, one thing, the context of those spaces, because they are protest spaces, are very different. But also, I think in terms of this election, what we need to understand is not just understanding, the hick or the uneducated as just racist or filled with hate, but that they feel isolated. They feel like they are victims, which is absurd in a lot of ways, obviously. But that's the core of what is going on, right? And that's why those discourses and that rhetoric are so appealing to them. And so to me, getting at that sort of core of why they feel that way, why they feel disenfranchised from the rest of the country, why they feel that they are, victims and that sort of thing, and why they're alienated is part of the work of dialogue and listening, because that's how you solve that problem, right? Is to start before that, like to start before it gets to the Dylan Roof point, right? To sort of see what it is that's going on that is leading to that, to those messages being something that's appealing.
You know, I want to just comment on this, and this is not necessarily an answer, but I really like the question once again. And I was thinking about this at the end of the election, when there was all of this speculation about how did this happen? How did this happen? And one of the speculations was that there was a huge percentage, obviously, population of people who were Trump supporters, but could not articulate that they were Trump supporters, right? And so they were sort of secret supporters. And I'm interested in that secrecy, right? I'm interested in an environment that is created, whether that is specific to the white ivory tower relative to the question, how the question was posed, or whether that is within a larger kind of democratic society in which we close down the possibility of real critical everyday conversation about these issues, which would have led to a potential critical dialogue, which could have opened up new spaces of understanding a wide range of issues, so that potentially we would not have been as shocked, right? And we are, and we're devastated, some of us, right? But the question is, why were we shocked, right? And I think it was a lack of dialogue and maybe the climate and the environment that suppressed the ability for the Trump supporters to be able to speak loudly so that they can actually engage in a meaningful dialogue and we could tease through those issues in more meaningful, constructive kind of ways.
So I've been listening and trying to process and bring it all together and do so sort of with, you know, the range of I'm sort of mired in grief right now. I wish I could go to anger, but I'm still in grief. And so as I've been listening and thinking, I find myself struggling as a traditional scholar who mostly my intervention is my writing, and then it feels insufficient. And so particularly in these last couple of comments and questions, I guess I've come back to this for me as sort of where I think about moving forward and how we move forward individually and collectively. And I always come back to Beverly Daniel Tatum, whose words I always find so inspiring and so moving. And she writes about two really crucial points for me. And the first is that in talking about racism, she talks about a moving sidewalk, you know, the airport moving sidewalk. And you know, she says, we can walk along with it as active racists, getting faster and faster. Most of us don't do that. We can stand still, letting it go by. Many of us do that. Or we could actually turn and walk the other way against it. And that, for her, is the only way in which we resist, is we actually turn and walk the other way against it. And so I know for me it's sort of remembering that the complicity, right? The ways in which the reasons why we need to change our graduate student population, our undergraduate student population, the ways in which we need to work with and through and in our communities, the ways in which we need to be at least aware of the activist efforts that are going out there, even if we are not ourselves the ones, right? That's our walking against it. But then I also come back to her notion of sphere of influence, and that, like, I'm a professor, I walk into the class and I teach. I don't make big change, but actually, if I listen to her words, we all make change, right? Because we all have a sphere of influence and we figure out how it is that we act and move. And so these three amazing folks have given us so many ways of thinking this through in the conversation, and I almost feel as if the energy in the room has moved, at least for me, the energy in my body has moved as a part, as a response of being here with you. And so that's that kind of influence. And I know that we would like to have this conversation with them all evening, but we can't, except that just next door in Grant's Lawn H is our opening reception. And so we can continue the conversation there. And one more moment of thanks to these scholars and to our activists.